If I can't keep my head held high enough, I'll just be love and watch the smiles come, bring my spirits up. There's some shit I like to fix, but I still know that I'm blessed.
Welcome back to my coverage of the Kristin Smart case. We're second day in week 10, Tuesday, September 20th, 2022, in the Salinas Courthouse in Monterey, California. Before we begin, I'm going to explain today's going to be very different for me and for you. So it's going to be a crazy day. There's 7 witnesses coming to the stand all in one day, and that's a lot to handle. Especially when you're not there and I'm trying to piece together half a dozen sources, including cross fact checking because there's so many errors. The order may be a little wonky today, especially since JT Camp, our regular, actually was on the stand. Then Detective Cole came back to the stand, and then Camp returned back twice in one day. Here's the witness list for the day. Sorry, there's no picture of the final witness, Fitzpatrick. So first we have Angie, the DNA analyst, continuing from Monday, and she was continuing from the week prior as well. We have Shelby Liddell, the forensic specialist. She's coming back. We have Sheriff Nadal, and remember, he appeared briefly before, and today he won't be on the stand long, and I love him. Remember, he's the hero officer who saved that little boy from drowning by resuscitating him with CPR. Thanks again for your service, sir. Officer. Then we have JT Camp for the umpteenth time. And you can see here on Chris Lambert's chart that he has permanent seating there. So he's an important guy in this case. Then we have Cole, who's been instrumental in the case and the trial. He came on board in 2017, if my memory serves me correctly. A lot of people to keep track of in this trial, for sure. You can see Cole also has VIP seating, so he's always available to pop up on the stand as needed. Then Camp is back to the stand. And last we have Fitzpatrick. Okay, with all that being said, we have a big day ahead and a mini grand finale towards the end. I don't know about you, but this trial has been exhausting. I can't imagine how Kristin's family and loved ones have been feeling and how they're holding up. And even Chris Lambert, he must be running out of steam himself. I feel like I know Chris, although I've never met him. Maybe someday. He does crack me up. Today he says this, "Jurors, stuck in traffic." So I guess he's just chilling. What's up?
A forensic DNA analyst was back on the stand.
Angela continues reviewing her findings of the evidence sent to her by Detective Cole.
But before we get to that, we want to recap what was revealed during Angela Butler's testimony yesterday. Butler testified about soil samples that she received from the sheriff's office last year, but added that no DNA was able to be extracted, and some samples did return with a negative result for human blood. She also detailed samples taken from a canvas mattress pad that she says she received in November of 2019. Butler says she was able to determine that a small brownish stain on the mattress pad was a DNA mixture.
That was an excellent recap. I feel like yesterday was a brain twister with counting the positives and negatives, the presumptive test versus the confirmatory test. So that wrapped it up in a nice little bow for us. Thank you, sir.
Tuesday morning, forensic DNA analyst Angela Butler was back on the stand, beginning with an awkward back and forth between defense attorney Robert Sanger and the witness over her knowledge of detecting pH levels in liquids.
Have you noticed that jury questions have really slowed down, man? They were on a roll for a minute. I missed them. But today we have a jury question. Question is, can Butler tell blood type from the samples? Answer, no. You need liquid blood to determine blood type. It's just not possible. Can't even get DNA from it, was her full answer.
Sanger asked her if she knew the basis on how pH levels are calculated, to which Butler responded that the number of hydrogen ions in a collected sample determine its pH value.
I feel like this is the type of testimony that can be a little tricky for jurors, especially since they've been through so much. Their brains are probably so twisted by now.
In her testimony, Butler explained that collected samples are handled by the software GMapper, which uses algorithms based on uncertainty to determine whether DNA samples of individuals in her findings are to be included or excluded.
See what I mean? Algorithms and everything. And take it from me, there's been a lot of difficult words throughout this trial. No joke.
Robert Singer then displayed an allele table of her collected data to the courtroom, where he questioned Butler on why there were samples that showed more allele findings than others. He asked Butler if she had swabbed the mattress in a deliberate effort to avoid obtaining DNA findings from certain areas and not others. Butler denied the allegation, saying that during her search of a specific stain that was found on the mattress, she wanted to isolate her findings to the one stain spot in particular, and that she wasn't interested in examining any additional touch DNA.
Oh no, not the dreaded alleles. I didn't even know how to say that word in the other episode. It's basically related to DNA sequencing, chromosomal genome, nucleotides. Lots of fun words like that.
Singer then asked for Butler to confirm that the DNA from both Paul and Kristin could neither be eliminated nor included in the sample findings on that mattress stain, and that their DNA had been excluded from the other items she examined. Butler confirmed those findings to the court.
That was a great overview of some of the more technical things that we've had to sink our teeth into so far. And now we're going to head into more from Angela Butler on today's testimony, Tuesday, September 20th, 2022. Angie continues to go a little deeper into the testimony from yesterday with more clarification. She describes the package contents as damp, sandy soil. Upon further examination, she noticed some unusual pieces in the soil and a variety of colors as well. And it does get a little tense during cross-examination again with Singer and this female witness. Don't know if it's related or not. I guess he did go a little bit after Justin as well, the witness who sent in the tip to the FBI. But anyway, I digress. So Singer starts off by saying he's going back to a different subject. He wants to know, did the materials look essentially the same in the 2021 and 2022 materials received? Objection. Vague. Sustained. Next question. Well, were they in similar plastic containers? Answer. Yes. The 2022 batch was not the same stickiness I observed in the first batch. Likelihood the ratio 1 is considered neutral or uninformative. For inclusive or exclusion. Paul and Kristin were slightly above 1, but too low to support a conclusion. Singer asked Butler if she'd ever analyzed soil from burial sites before, and she answered she had not. She was not present when the evidence was collected. No bones or cloth was found. She did find possible hairs, and she sent those to another lab for analysis. The hair was not detected. Singer looks at the clock at noon and tells Judge O'Keefe, "It's going to be another 5 to 10 minutes, Your Honor." Butler is asked to remain after lunch. Cross-examination lasted till after the noon break.
Singer's cross-examination of Butler lasted until the afternoon break.
Singer went on with his soil questions for Butler, trying to establish the DNA and the blood and all that good stuff. And then it was Misick's turn. He asked Butler about tools used. She said that she uses a stereo microscope and tweezers. She said she could not ID the DNA, and the blood was not linked to Reuben. At the end of Misick's testimony, he inferred that Butler could not draw conclusions from her findings. The prosecution came back again and asked if she worked with Elizabeth Johnson. The answer was yes. She worked a few defense cases with her. All right, it's been a minute. Let's do a mini rabbit hole. I had to bite on this one. I've heard her name a few times now, Dr. Elizabeth Johnson. Last time, there was an objection, so we never heard any more of her. Now, today, just this itty-bitty mention, and then that's it. Either there was more testimony that wasn't reported on, or that was it. Come on down the rabbit hole with me. We'll be right back. So, Dr. Elizabeth Johnson, she has a PhD in immunology, which is a forensic scientist specializing in evidence examination, and she's been doing this since 1991, and she actually established a DNA lab in Harris County, Texas. The first part of the rabbit hole, I stumbled on this feature regarding the technology that helped with Paul's arrest, and they thank Serological Research Institute. It was one of the many cases mentioned here. It was actually one of the first ones they mentioned. So far, this Dr. Elizabeth sounds legit. So why is she the forbidden fruit? Oh, here we go. Looks like she uncovered major problems at a crime lab. Here she states, those assurances are not enough. She is quoted in many articles. She discusses incompetence, saying they don't understand testing. She expressed that there's doubts on how they interpret the testing, calling the labs a mess. Sorry about that. It can be very noisy around here sometimes. So as I was saying before I was so really interrupted by the car alarm, she was talking about how there were 68 prison terms actually in question because of the problems, and even rainwater was running into the buildings where the testing was done. My goodness sakes. Ah, I think I get where Sanger wanted to go with that. Do you guys see where he's going? I think he wanted to enter how mistakes can happen in the labs, and it causes wrongful convictions. In my opinion, what do you think? Okay, let's resurface from our rabbit hole now. We got to get back to testimony. There's tons of people still to hear from today. My gosh. And then Sanger came back again and was asking about publicity, and she admitted discussions at the lab regarding Kristin Smart's case. This next exchange was hard to get the context, but I do believe I have it in the proper placement. So Sanger says, quote, well, did you talk to anybody? Prosecution objects on 352 for relevance, and Sanger says, can I finish my question? The judge asks counsel to approach for a sidebar. There's a 2-minute sidebar, and all agree that Detective Cole will take the stand. That must be later in the day, because from here we still have to hear from Shelby, then Nadal, and then Camp, and then finally Cole. So a little weird, but wanted to include that in there, just showing how they bicker with each other so much. They're always at each other's throats. Next to take the stand was Shelby Liddell. Remember her? She's back. She's the really pretty forensic specialist we heard from earlier in the trial. She was only on the stand briefly. The prosecution showed her a picture of the cargo trailer parked at Ruben's, as well as photos of bedding from Paul's San Pedro home. Ew, bedding! Oh, gross. Sorry, I just threw up in my mouth a little bit there. Ugh. It's Paul's rape bed, according to the victim's testimony. Are any of you as creeped out as I am that Paul would try to contact his rape victims after he violently assaulted them and drugged them to the point where they were passing out? He's just beyond clueless. Ugh. Apparently, Shelby was called to the stand today just to enter those photos previously mentioned into evidence. I'm a wee bit concerned about the bedding. It's the first it's been brought up. I guess we're just going to have to wait and see. The hero cop, Deputy Nadal, is back on the stand. Remember the one that saved the little boy from drowning? Sorry, he's one of my favorites. How can he not be? Well, he was back on the stand today, and he was reviewing the search warrant that he was a part of at Paul's San Pedro home in Southern California. So he described that there was a sunroom at Paul's house, and that's where they located a Dell computer, which they took into evidence. And this is starting to be like when they set the stage for the end act where everybody comes and bows and the curtain goes down and they come out and bow again. I feel like they're circling the wagons and we're heading into something big here. I can feel it. I previously mentioned that Camp testifies just for a couple questions, and then Cole is called to the stand. Since I can't differentiate exactly what those questions were, I'm just going to combine them all together when Camp comes back to the stand. The prosecution asks, Detective Cole, does the Sheriff's Department have the white Nissan pickup in evidence? Answer, yes. Question, is it two or four-wheel drive? Answer, two-wheel drive. A photo is introduced of Mike McConville's cargo trailer parked along Ruben's house with the back doors facing the backyard. Jeez, what a mess. I feel like Singer now. Just kidding. But I think I did figure out the little bit of testimony where Camp briefly came up. I'm so sorry, guys. Here's Camp. Here we go. They review the DMV records for the blue-green Ford Ranger and a white Nissan pickup truck. They're able to confirm the transfer of ownership in reviewing the DMV records where the white pickup truck was transferred from Reuben to Paul. And here's a black and white picture of Paul with his blue-green truck, which he bought with money he earned flipping burgers at Garland's, the local burger stand. That's on the playlist if you want to see the outside of that place. So they talked about how the truck was reported stolen. And Sanger asked Camp if he collaborated with the prosecution to discuss strategies. And with this, Prevail objects, and the judge has them go aside for discussion with all the attorneys. And then Cole comes to the stand. All right, so I put those pieces together. That objection on 352 grounds that seemed oddly placed in context earlier was associated with this. And now, like I said, Cole comes to the stand. It's not raised up, right? Cole answers, it's definitely not. Now, it's been dismantled. Yikes. Question, you found the truck in Mexico? Answer, I did not. That was Detective Kenny. And there's no evidence it was lifted? Answer, no. Prosecution recrossed. But you don't know it wasn't lifted in 96? Answer, no, I do not. The prosecution on redirect also asks, were you in court when Jennifer testified that it appeared to be a four-wheel drive in 1996? Answer, yes. Question. So there is evidence, correct? Sanger, objection. I have a motion. And the prosecution says, he opened the door, Your Honor. Man, Sanger's escalating again. Okay, then Sanger says, quote, I have a motion. Mr. Prevail knows better. Knows better than that. Judge Jennifer O'Keefe calls a recess at 3:14 p.m. while the attorneys hold a hearing. All right, guys, as soon as I heard this, this song popped into my head, and I also like this movie as well. So, here it is. Wait for it. We knew it was coming. Sanger says he has a motion for mistrial for prosecutorial misconduct. Sanger says this is not the TV show Law and Order. Mr. Prevail asked a clearly leading question, Sanger says. And that's so funny because I was just talking about the context of movies versus court. Okay, let's let that sink in for a bit. Sanger is not feeling like a winner, in my opinion. More desperate attempts to save Paul's cooked goose. We are not going to go through this again. Sorry, Mr. Sanger. Judge O'Keefe reads from the court reporter's record. The question was, quote, were you present in court when Jennifer testified that it appeared to be a four-wheel drive? Sanger says, Mr. Prevail used the word it. Jennifer never identified this truck. Sanger says she testified she saw a four-wheel drive truck. Clearly that truck was not this truck. Mr. Prevell asked something like, "And that's evidence, isn't it?" "That's just totally inappropriate. I think it's prosecutorial misconduct, and I make a motion for mistrial." Sanger also says, "I would still like to ask if Jennifer was shown a picture of this truck." Judge O'Keefe says, "You may ask that. It was just a suggestion." The jurors return at 3:24 p.m., and Sanger says, "You never showed this picture of this truck to Jennifer?" Cole says, "I did not." Sanger says, "So she said she saw this person who was described as Paul Flores driving a four-wheel drive truck." Cole answers, "She said a white four-wheel drive truck." Sanger then asks, "And this was after the podcaster had shown her some drone video or something of a white four-wheel drive truck?" Prevail, objection, misstates the testimony, sustained. Then Detective Cole was excused at 3:25 p.m. J.T. Camp is back again. Prosecution's question, "Did you serve a search warrant at Ruben's house on May 21st of 2021? Answer, yes. It was a warrant to obtain a buccal swab. Kind of a glorified Q-tip used to get DNA. The prosecution asks Camp, "Who else did the warrant authorize for a buccal swab?" Camp answers, "Susan Flores and Mike McConville." Camp says he and Detective Cole had set up an appointment with defense attorney Harold Misick to collect Ruben Flores' buccal swab. Camp said, "We made contact with Ruben Flores at his front door. He had set up a table in front so we couldn't enter past the threshold." Side note, that's pretty crafty. "We chatted for a bit. At one point, Detective Cole went back to his car to retrieve some gloves. Mr. Flores was shown a copy of the warrant papers." Side note, you notice how they're always thinking ahead? The way that the Flores' mind thinks. Wouldn't be surprised if Susan told him to put the table there, in my opinion. "We chatted for a bit. At some point, he got to a part where the warrant mentioned that Susan Flores and Mike McConville would also be swabbed." Prevell sets up an audio clip, and a bailiff passes out a one-page transcript to the jurors. Sanger and Misick both renew their previous objections to the audio being played, but they are overruled. The clip begins with Detective Cole speaking into his recorder. It's 13:25 hours. Cole and Camp knock on Ruben's front door. He answers and tells them to stay outside of the doorway. "Oh, listen to the music." The Doobie Brothers is playing. I know I'm not a singer, but I do like the Doobie Brothers. So they're playing loudly inside the house. Ruben asks what happened to the DNA taken after his arrest, and Cole explains that they need a buccal swab for his cheek for direct comparison. Camp hands Ruben the search warrant, and he begins to read it. Cole says, "Let me go get my gloves. I forgot gloves." Cole can be heard walking to his car for gloves and then returning to the doorway. Ruben asks why Susan Flores and Mike McConville are listed in the warrant. Cole says, "We're going to swab them after you." Ruben says he does not understand why they are also being swabbed, and he sounds irritated. And he says, quote, "I mean, they haven't committed no felonies, only me." Ruben quickly corrects himself, quote, "I mean, I'm the only one who was arrested." The prosecution asked Camp, "Did he appear concerned with what he had said?" Answer, "I think so, yes." Defense attorney Harold Misick says, quote, "My client was cooperative, right?" Camp answers, "Correct." And Misick says, "You're aware that he was already previously swabbed?" Answer, "Yes." Next question by Misick, "Do you know how old my client is?" Answer, "Not off the top of my head." Misick, "If I told you he was 80, would it surprise you?" Answer, "No." Misick attempts to explain that Ruben's age caused his confusion. That's convenient. "Did you see what else it said there? That it's anticipated that the defense will rest by the end of the month?" Wow. Dang, we're moving on to another witness. We're jamming today. The witness is Christopher Fitzpatrick, and he is a computer forensic specialist. So he's going to take the stand and talk about how he received Paul's Dell computer as evidence. Fritz explained the Dell computer had this video that's about to be entered into court, a still shot from the video at least. And we know what that video was. He did tape himself raping women. It also had several years of Paul's tax returns and photographs of Paul, Susan, Ruben, Irma, Linda. So it's pretty confirmed it's his computer. I don't think he can get out of that one. And also found on the desk in his house. Oh my. Another one of my questions I mentioned a few episodes back has now been answered. Remember the red ball gag with black straps? Well, they seized it from Paul's house. That's some pretty creepy stuff. He used that ball gag to assault people, according to evidence. And for me, it's strong evidence of the multiple rapes, in my opinion. Those ladies couldn't guess to describe the ball gag to a T like that. Man, Paul is a POS. And I know he's not on trial for rape, but this sets his modus operandi and how he's been in life and what he's done to women and what he continued to do. So that's the relevance. Before the photograph can be shown, Sanger asks the judge to admonish the jury before the still photo is shown. Judge O'Keefe says, quote, "Ladies and gentlemen, this evidence is being admitted only to confirm that Mr. Flores owned a red ball gag." With that, Prevail is able to publish this photograph, and it's a screenshot from the video that we already heard about. I found on Paul Flores's computer, and it shows a close-up of a woman's face. Her eyes are closed, and there is a red ball gag in her mouth with black straps. She's on a bed with a white sheet or pillowcase with green foliage print. And luckily, we cannot see her face because it sounds terrifying, but that's what the jury saw, and here's what we're able to see. Even hearing about the picture of the lady with a ball gag freaked me out. As you know, I have a wild imagination. And I actually got goosebumps. It was literally chilling. Even though we can't see it, I can envision it. Just seeing his bed sheets, I don't know, it just creeps me out. And this is the first I've heard of this picture. I knew of the homemade video. So even though we can see here in the picture the bed and the pillow, and like I said, that's enough for me to imagine her. It's terrifying. I would never be able to get her face out of my brain. So I'm glad I didn't see it. So let's see. Regarding the Dell computer, neither Sanger nor Misek had any other questions after that. I would imagine they might want to leave that one alone. I think they thought better of asking questions regarding this evidence. I wonder why jury questions are so scarce these days. I wonder, are they pooped? Are they bored? Have they already decided? Or what is going on? Well, Fitzpatrick was excused at 3:50 p.m. And now, can I get a drum roll, please? So, Mr. Prevail said he had no additional witnesses, Your Honor. And at this time, the people rest. I'm wondering if the sexual assault victim, Doe 3, changed her mind. We never even heard from her. There's some others, too. I hope she's okay. Looks like I'm not the only person thrown off and wondering about the third sexual assault victim and her testimony. But can you believe it, guys? Prosecution rests. And then Sanger says he'll begin at 8:30 a.m. Wednesday morning to start his testimony and call his witnesses, and the jurors were excused at 3:52 p.m., but unfortunately that wasn't the end of the day, so here we go. Outside the presence of the jurors, Sanger asked to put on the record his objection to the final exhibit. He says this photograph is unduly prejudicial. It is 1101A evidence to support 1108 evidence. Therefore, it's tangible. Therefore, it's tangential. Tangential. I'm not sure. There has been no evidence of an attempted rape or rape. The picture is obviously shocking. In fact, I think I heard a few jurors shift in their seats when it was shown. There's no context to who, what, when these photos were taken. It's going to have a lasting prejudicial effect on my client, said Sanger. Defense attorney Misick joins Sanger's objection and submits without adding anything further. Prevail says the people's original request was to admit the entire video. The court denied that and asked me to generate still photographs the court could choose from. I asked the court to further consider admitting one of several clips that showed the face of Paul Flores. That was also denied. The court engaged in substantial curation of the evidence, specifically to accommodate the defense objections. The probative value could not be higher. It corroborates both of our 1108 victims. Judge O'Keefe says the court initially saw the video during an in limine motion. The people requested to admit it, but the court denied initially. The people subsequently requested the court consider allowing the video as corroboration evidence for the two individuals named Doe. I reviewed the video in its entirety. The court frankly found the video shocking. However, the probative value of corroborating the testimony significantly outweighs the prejudicial effect. Mr. Bell provided me with 6 still photos and also numerous clips which depicted that individual and Mr. Flores. The court endeavored to select the least inflammatory still from that video, which depicted the ball gag and a pillowcase located in Mr. Flores's bedroom. Defense attorney Sanger says, the defense makes a motion for judgment of acquittal. My position is that there is no evidence of a murder, rape, or attempted rape. There's a reason this case hadn't been prosecuted for over 25 years. A motion for acquittal is called for. Defense attorney Harold Misick says, there's no just and sufficient evidence, but a complete lack of evidence. The blood can't be sourced to anyone. No significance could be assigned to the fibers. Mr. Flores clearly just misspoke. He hasn't committed any crime. I'm sorry, but a hole in the ground under his deck is not evidence. Prevail says, I would ask the court to deny the defense 118 motion. I will highlight a few pieces. There's no doubt that Kristin Smart is dead. She had plans that weekend. She wasn't going anywhere. Prevail highlights the testimony of the state's witnesses, pointing out that several people testified that Paul Flores essentially targeted Kristin prior to the Crandall Way party. When Paul Flores says he had no idea who she was, that was a bald-faced lie. Prevail highlights the testimony of witnesses who saw Paul Flores interacting with, watching, or asking about Kristin Smart. Clearly, Paul Flores was interested in Kristin Smart. He points out that while no witnesses saw Kristin drinking at the party, she was incapacitated on the front lawn for hours. When Paul Flores came out of the shadows, out of nowhere, to help her walk home. His intent was, and is, to target women at the conclusion of a social function to take advantage of them. He adds that Paul repeatedly tried to get Cheryl to leave him alone with Kristin while walking her back to her dorm. And when Cheryl finally did leave them, Paul claims he left Kristin Smart basically 2 football fields away from her dorm. He lied to law enforcement multiple times, and we saw videos where he admits to telling them white lies and fibs, as he called them. He is basically a pathological liar, lying through his teeth. To believe Paul's story, the court would have to believe that everybody else is in a grand conspiracy to convict Paul Flores. When Kristin Smart was reported missing, thousands rallied to her, but Paul and Ruben Flores did not. When Stan Smart came to Ruben Flores' home to speak to him, Ruben chased him off and threatened that someone might get shot if they didn't leave. When Angie later went into Ruben Flores' backyard, she was whisked away from that area by Paul and Ruben. Pavrell says when investigators searched Ruben Flores' house in 2020, they found a treasure trove of Kristin Smart's paraphernalia. It's a collection of someone who has a perverse obsession with Kristin. A tenant heard Ruben Flores call Kristin Smart a dirty slut, an odd thing to say about a stranger he never met, unless he knew there was a sexual component to what occurred between Paul and Kristin. Prevail also walks through the cadaver dog evidence, the GPR anomaly under Ruben's deck, the soil staining, the subsequent positive test for human blood. The logical conclusion is that both defendants are guilty. Defense attorney Robert Sanger says, I think Mr. Prevail's imagination is quite active. And Misick says, there's an innocent explanation for every bit of that evidence found under Mr. Flores's deck. There is absolutely no evidence that this girl is dead. This is Misek still talking. For all we know, she's out in Dubai or in the Middle East somewhere, living a fine life. Judge O'Keefe denies the defense motion for acquittal. Thank goodness. The court is going to respectfully deny the 118 motion in both cases. We will continue tomorrow. Judge O'Keefe says Sanger has not had the opportunity to finish going through the exhibits, he had admitted, but there is not enough time to finish them today. The defense is scheduled to call their first witness at 8:30 a.m. tomorrow. So let's touch on some of the witnesses we were told we would hear from that we have not. Doe 3, another sexual assault victim. Susan Flores was told she'd have to testify. Maybe Sanger's calling her and not the prosecution. I don't know. And then Chris Lambert was possibly going to testify. That also could be Sanger calling him, or he may be off the hook. I don't know. And there's still no word on the motion to televise the closing arguments or the verdicts. I'd really like to know more about that, too. I've just got to say it again. The prosecution rests its case.
Just into our newsroom, the people rested their case in the Kristin Smart murder trial. Today was their last witness that they brought to the stand in the case against Paul and Ruben Flores.
And I am so excited. I just can't hide it. I knew it. I felt it. I got a burst of endorphins when I read the headlines. Are you all excited? Do you think Sanger will make short work of this? I certainly hope so. I personally don't expect Misek to present much, but I could be wrong. I'm starting to taste justice for Kristin. Oh, please, Lord, bring us justice for Kristin. I know many of us have been disappointed that there is so little coverage of Kristen's trial. But this takes it to the next level, in my opinion. That evening, and at least by noon, there was zero media coverage at all outside local sources, even announcing that the prosecution had rested its case. They didn't get to it till literally the next day. Just they've got other things to do, I guess. Things like this here. They were literally playing the 1992 trial of Jeffrey Dahmer because that's more important. Well, either way, there's some of us that are never going to forget her. I love the sound of this. The defense is expected to rest before the end of the month, so before October even.
And it is now the defense's turn to begin calling witnesses to the stand. That is expected to begin tomorrow.
As always, justice for Kristin Denise Smart.
If I can't keep my head held high enough, I'll just be love and watch the smiles come.
Thanks for watching.
Bring my spirits up.
Don't forget to stop and smell the flowers.
There's some shit I like to fix, but I still know that I'm blessed.